sing this morning, when all I see.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me.
There's nothing to fear.
And there's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
So when I fight,
so when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. No, God, battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, and I sing through the night. No, God, battle belongs to you.
If you are for me,
and if you are for me, then can be against me. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. And when all I see are the ashes, you see them, yeah. When all I see is a cross, and God, you see the empty tomb. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power.
Let's declare that this morning.
An almighty fortress. You go before us. And nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle, and nothing can stand against the power.
Come on, one more time.
An almighty fortress, you go before us, and nothing can stand against the power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, you
is Sea of Victory. And actually, the theme of our opening set is God's victory. Every song, it talked about God's victory. And I think this week I've been really challenged with so many battles and weapons that seemed like they were forming against me. And as I was praying through this set, God reminded me that I'm going to see a victory because the battle belongs to God. And the weapons, it may feel like it's forming against me, but it's not going to prosper. Because when I let go of my battles, when I try to fight my battles, I'm not going to win. But when God is fighting the battles, he's gonna win. So, and as we sing this last song, Sea of Victory, you know, if you're going through battles and if you feel like there are weapons forming against you, I want to encourage and challenge you to really sing out the words. Even though it feels like it's so hard to say that I'm going to see a victory because the battle belongs to God, it could be really hard, but I do want to just challenge you and maybe push you a little bit to see what God will do when you let go and give the battle to him. And if you've experienced God's victory, I hope that this song can be a reminder of when we experience God's victory, how victorious it is. So yeah, that's just the hope for this last song, Sea of Victory.
Turn it for good. You turn.
worship our way through our battles, God. Even though it feels like there are weapons forming against us, even though it seems like the world is against us, even though we don't understand why sometimes things happen that happens to people that don't deserve, but God, we let all that go, because the battle belongs to you, and we're going to see victory in you. And God, as we ready our hearts to listen to the word and hear the testimony of our dear brother, will you empty our hearts and our minds so that you can fill in? God, we thank you for this morning where we can come as one body to give you worship. God, thank you for that privilege. In your name we pray. Amen. You may all be seated.
Please turn with me to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. We're going to look at verses 34 through 48. Acts chapter 10, verse 34 through 48. As always, we have it up on our screens, but if you have your own Bibles with you, I want to encourage you to turn with me, and I'll be reading from the English Standard Version, so you can follow along with whichever translation that you may have. Acts chapter 10, starting from verse 34. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Again, thank you, Daniel, for your testimony. We're so excited, especially after all these years, to be able to not only send our church family members to various parts of the world, but to also to be able to hear what God has been showing them, what God is challenging us through the ways that he is giving us these opportunities. This Friday, myself, TK, and Ellis, as part of Story of Media Labs, will be traveling to India for the next 10 days. And so we want to ask for your prayers. It's the first time in many years that we'll be going back to India. We're going to go visit the Justice Hub that we've been funding through JVI for many, many years. We're also going to go see the factory that you've all helped fund build in the area of Dulian, so that the work of creating jobs and opportunities, employment for the women of that West Bengal region can continue. We're also going to be participating in a board meeting with Joya. As you know, this organization is evolving and it's growing, and we've been invited to come and brainstorm with them and dream with them further partnership as a church, as we continue to invest in that particular part of the country. And so continue to pray for us, not only for safety, but God would just show us again and again his faithfulness in the ways that he's been working, even throughout the pandemic and beyond. Now, for this morning, we come back to Acts chapter 10. I know we've been jumping around a little bit. We've had different guest speakers and things, and I trust that you've been challenged and blessed, even from last week from our brother Jamal. And I'll address a little bit of what he shared too in our message, because I think it's just so appropriate in God's sovereignty in kind of weaving, even from voices from beyond our church, the ways in which we see the Holy Spirit moving and acting throughout this early church. If you recall in Acts chapter 10 that we opened with a couple of weeks ago, we talked about this second, if you will, monumental, historical, pivotal moment in the early church. The first was in Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit, the promised Spirit of God, actually came and fell upon the people. It empowered them to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And in Acts chapter 10, we saw this next big shift, this seismic transition from people understanding that the mystery of God, once hidden, now revealed in Christ, is that all people, including the Gentiles, were to be included in the family of God. And it all surrounded around this bizarre dream, this psychedelic vision that Peter has about this bedsheet that comes from heaven with all kinds of animals. And the voice of God says to Peter, eat. Now, what we saw is that Cornelius, again, a Gentile, he is a Roman centurion of the Italian cohort, send for this Peter. Peter is going to come back, and the verses that we just read, starting from verse 34, is his conversation with Cornelius after he goes with his servants to Cornelius in response to Cornelius's request. Because he sends servants to Peter and says, hey, I've had this vision. I've been told to invite you to where I am. And this voice told me, this angel told me that you're going to explain the gospel, the scriptures to me. Now, starting from Acts chapter 10, and into Acts chapter 11, what you're going to see is Peter explaining his vision so many times. And Luke is going to recount this vision over and over and over again. He's going to explain it to different groups of people, here to Cornelius. He's going to have this vision later on. He's going to explain it to the apostles and then to those in Jerusalem. He's going to repeat it. This vision is going to come out over and over, pretty much the entirety of chapter 10 and 11. I ask myself, why so often? And sometimes the simplest answer, I think, is the most logical one. And that is because it is important. Again, it marks a shift, a monumental shift, not only in the way we understand the mystery of God, but I think what Luke is trying to do is that he's explaining one of the core outcomes of the cross that we're supposed to see in Acts chapter 10, particularly through his vision. Three of which, right? One is our forgiveness in sins. And because of the forgiveness that we experience through the cross, our reconciliation to the Father, that we were separated, but now we're able to draw near. But what we're going to see repeated over and over again in Peter's vision, this mystery that has come to light, is that now we have been reconciled not only to God, but to one another. That there is nothing that divides us. That the wall that used to separate people has been brought down through Christ. And so what I want to do for us for the remainder of our time is to walk through these verses, and I want to show you, okay, why this is so important, how this starts to pertain with us, to us, and how we are to understand, especially as we draw close almost to the series in Acts that we've been going through this entire year, okay? So let's jump through or go through this together, starting from verse 34. What we're starting to see is that Peter is making sense. He's understanding that the dots are starting to connect. Peter opened his mouth. He's talking to Cornelius. And he says, truly, I understand now. I'm starting to put the pieces together, this mystery that has been revealed before me, this vision, this bizarre dream. I'm starting to get it. Because remember in verse 17, he's like, I still don't understand. But now he does. He's getting it. That God shows no partiality. That there is no division in God, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. Now, in a little bit, we're going to see how this is not a new revelation. God has been speaking this to the Old Testament church, to the Old Testament Jews from all those times ago, and I'm going to show you this, but now Peter is starting to put the pieces together, and he says, I get it. The mystery that has been revealed to us through the Spirit of God is that there is no division among God's people, that we are all one in Christ. Verse 35, verse 36, as for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. And then he continues to tell his testimony. He tells his sermon, if you will, that he's preached so many other times. Now, without going too much detail, this is going to be a little bit of a tangent. I want to pause here and make note of Peter's preaching. Because throughout the book of Acts, we've seen Peter preach very similarly, where he talks about the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. Okay, various different places throughout the book of Acts. Now, I want to take a moment and make a distinction between what Peter is doing and I think what a lot of us think of when we say the word testimony. Okay, what Peter is doing here, starting from verse 36, is that he is preaching and proclaiming the gospel. Right? The evangelion, the good news. Now, I want us to be very clear that what Peter is doing is a little bit different from what we may say when we say that we give a testimony. So, for example, when we share our testimony like our brother Daniel did, oftentimes it's surrounded with my life and how Christ has interacted with me. So we often share stories of how Jesus has changed my life, right? How Christ has saved me. Or even when we give our testimony, we say, I have good news for you. Jesus loves you. And it is good news indeed. But I want you to notice again, this is surrounding my response to what Christ has done. The focus is in my life. What Peter does so oftentimes, again, repeated in Acts chapter 10, starting from verse 36 onwards to verse 42, he's not giving a testimony. He's, in fact, preaching the gospel. Now, here's the difference. Now, not totally separate, but here's the difference. When Peter is preaching the gospel, compared to a testimony which is surrounded about how God has interacted with me, the gospel, the evangelion, the good news, centers around the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. So again, even in the verses that we've just read here, it's not even just, yes, Christ has saved me. This is how he's changed my life. Jesus loves me. Absolutely, that is part of the good news. But the word, the gospel, the proclamation of good news, this evangelical preaching that God has called us to do as we share, is not just centered around how God has worked in my life, but the way that we see how Peter has done so often is talking about Jesus's life, is his life. So I want us to be sure about this because, again, so often we think about interacting with our neighbors and it's like, well, let me just share my testimony, which is great. It is still good news because we're testifying to how Christ has changed my life. But the work that God has often called us to do does not end with just a testimony. It's about proclaiming the life and ministry of Jesus, how in Christ we find not only forgiveness, but resurrection, renewal, and transformation. I think this is going to be important because so often we get lost in making sure that we're not these weirdos, right? Talking about someone who existed 2,000 years ago, how he died, he resurrected. But make no mistake, brothers and sisters, in the repetition over and over again in the early church, and especially as we're being sent, this is going to be something that we have to proclaim. The life, death, ministry, resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, his life, and how that has transformed us. Again, a little bit of a side note. So Peter proclaims, he teaches, he gives this evangelion, the fullness of the goodness of God. Now, let's jump down to verse 44. While Peter was still saying these things, right? He's proclaiming the gospel, he's saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles, for they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" Now, I'm not going to spend too much time here because, again, I've explained this before, but here's the big shift, the seismic shift in the history of the early church. what we're seeing is that in the same way that the Holy Spirit came upon the Jews, the chosen people of God, in Acts chapter 10 through Peter's vision and now confirmed through the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we're seeing that this door has been open. It's been broken. It's been wide, you know, the gates have been flung wide open so that all now, even Gentiles, can receive, can be part of the family of God. The conclusion, the point, the thing that amazes the circumcised, that will be Peter, right? Luke records this detail. The people who are of the chosen, what amazes them, the point that they're so blown away by is that, look, the mystery that God has revealed now, hidden for ages, is that nobody, nobody is excluded from the family of God. So the logic that Peter is using as he baptizes these Gentiles, quote unquote, is how can we withhold the baptism of the water, right? The way in which Christ was baptized by John the Baptist. How can we withhold this? Because again, remember, it was reserved for the chosen people of God. How can we do this when the Holy Spirit has now so clearly shown to us that they're already a part of God's family through the work of Jesus Christ? So again, the point surrounding this, the reason why this is such a monumental event is to saying, look, do you see? From ages past, this is what God has intended for all people to be included. That was the conclusion, the point, the climax that the people who are reading, who are part of what's taking place in Acts chapter 10 would have come to, would have been in awe of. Now, in today's time, as we fast forward 2,000 years, there's an unfortunate new conclusion that has been drawn from this passage. And I want you to read very carefully and work this through with me. A lot of people will use this passage, particularly in Acts chapter 10, starting from verse 44 to 47 and 48, to describe a difference, almost a division between those who have the Spirit and those who do not have the Holy Spirit's baptism. So unlike the early church who are experiencing this with Peter for the first time, their conclusion is all people have been included in the family of God. Today, many people use this passage to say, well, there is a division now, not only between Jew and Gentile, but between those who have and those who have not the Spirit of God. Now, the logical explanation for this is this. If you remember, the Gentiles that Luke refers to, not only in chapter 10, but in the other verses, starting from Acts chapter 9, these are people who already believe in the Old Testament God. They're referred to as these God-fearers. So remember a couple of chapters ago, the Ethiopian eunuch, right? This Ethiopian could have been, you know, someone who represents the ends of the world, right? Someone who is so far outside the family of God. But this Ethiopian eunuch traveled, remember, thousands of miles to come and worship at Jerusalem, at that place where you find God. So he's already believing in God. In Acts chapter 10, we hear of this Italian centurion. He is also described as a God-fearer. So the believing in this Yahweh God has already taken place. And so what people will do is that they will take this passage in Acts 10, verse 44 to 48, and say, well, there is a time lapse between when they actually believed in this Yahweh God, when the Holy Spirit came and gave them the Spirit of God. There has been a passing of time. And so until you get the Holy Spirit's baptism, you're not fully included into the family of God. So now what you start to find is the division, missing the entire point of why Acts 10 is such a monumental moment. It's not even the fact that the gates of who can be invited into God's family has been flung wide open, but now it's been a further division between those who have the Holy Spirit of God and those who do not. And so you find these weird interpretations of people who are, if you don't exercise the gifts of the Holy Spirit, it means that you're only still part of the have-nots. That you have to have certain expressions of the Holy Spirit to be a part of this Holy Spirit's baptisms. And what you're seeing is this division taking place between those who have and do not have. Now, church, why make such a big deal of this? And why be so careful in us understanding this? It's because what is causing this section, right? The fact that all people, all Gentiles, not just the Jews, to be included in the family of God, so significant is because in our human nature, particularly in our sinfulness, one of our knee-jerk reactions to our sinfulness is to divide ourselves based upon what we have and what we do not have. So in our day and age today, we divide ourselves based on race. We divide ourselves based on our socioeconomic status. We divide ourselves some on this theology where we say some of us have the blessing of the Holy Spirit, others do not. In our sinfulness, the human nature tends to divide, right? We separate with those that are less. We automatically look at hierarchy. I mean, you think about walking into a room, whether it's in a work function or school function or social function, one of the first things that we do, right, is to figure out where your pecking order is. It's in our human nature to divide ourselves. It plays out even in our understanding of Jews and Gentiles. Now, if you're like me, when you hear the word Gentiles, you naturally associate the word unclean. Right, the Jews are the chosen people of God, and the Gentiles were these barbarian uncleans. Because that's particularly the way in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament that a lot of the chosen people of God would describe those who are of non-Jewish traditions. But brothers and sisters, I want you to be very clear. God himself actually never uses the word or declares that Gentiles are unclean. God actually never says that. Not in any of the Levitical laws, right, do you become unclean by associating with Gentiles. It was a perversion of our understanding of God's law that causes, again, this division between Jew and Gentile. Left to ourselves in our sinfulness and our brokenness, what we do, we're prone to finding things that separate us and saying, you stay in that lane, I stay in this lane. God never once declared Gentiles to be unclean. In fact, if you look with me up on the screen, starting from Numbers chapter 15, verses 14 through 16, right? We're going to look at two passages in the Old Testament. First, Numbers 15, starting from verse 14. And if a stranger, now the word stranger here is a traveler or a sojourner, right? It's talking about a foreigner, someone who is not a Jew. If a stranger is sojourning with you, traveling with you, or anyone is living permanently among you, and he or she wishes to offer a food offering, do as the chosen people of God do. Offer a sacrifice to the Lord. Notice what God says. With a pleasing aroma to the Lord, he shall do as you do. There's actually language already in the Old Testament where God has provided for those who are outside to say, hey, you, even if you are an outsider as you travel, if you desire to give an offering to the Lord, you can do as the Jews do, as the chosen people of God. For the assembly, there shall be one statute for you and the stranger who sojourns with you, a statute forever throughout your generations. Again, no language that these sojourners are unclean, they're not able to be a part of God's assembly. You can be invited. Look with me in Exodus chapter 12, starting from verse 47. Again, similar language. All the congregations of Israel shall keep this. It's talking about this Passover with God. If a stranger, again, a sojourner, a foreigner, an alien, a Gentile, shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover to the Lord. Okay? Again, the designation that Luke uses for these kinds of sojourners, foreigners in the book of Acts would be those who are God-fearers. If these Gentiles who are God-fearers choose to be a part and to take part, notice, he shall be a native of the land, right? He may come near and keep it. God has already explained that there is an avenue even for those that are foreigners, even those that are strangers, even those that are sojourners to be already a part of what God is doing. So this whole concept that only the Jews and the Gentiles have to remain outside. Remember, from the early book and the story of the book of Acts, when Peter and John going to the temple, remember the way that the Old Testament temple was set up. The court of the Gentiles, the court of the unclean, you can never come inside because why? You may actually lose your life. This isn't the way that God intended. They were invited to be a part of what God is doing from the very beginning. But in our brokenness, in our sinfulness, what do we find? We find divisions. We find these walls being put up based upon our desire to find our lane and our pecking orders. Now, what's interesting, though, is this. If you continue with Exodus 12 and even Numbers 15, and I think this is where some of the perversion takes place, read with me, verse 47, all the congregation of Israel shall keep it. If a stranger shall sojourn with you and will keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native to the Lord. But no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. Verse 49, there shall be one law for the native and for the stranger who sojourns among you. Now, keep that in mind and come back to Numbers chapter 15. Same thing, starting from verse 15. For the assembly, there shall be one statute for you and one for the stranger who sojourns with you, a statute forever throughout your generations. You and your sojourner shall be alike before the Lord. Now, what we find in both Numbers 15 and Exodus chapter 12 is that God has invited this traveler, this foreigner, to come within, to be as a native, as a chosen person of God. But there is very clear language that there is one particular instruction for those who are chosen and one particular set of instructions for those who are sojourners. Now, let me show you a graphical depiction of this. It's almost as if there are two, quote-unquote, churches that are taking place in the Old Testament scriptures. There's the inner core of the circumcised chosen people of God, and then there is another set of statutes for those outer circle of God-fearers. There are two. You are to be considered sane before the Lord, but the way in which we connect with God, there's almost been given two sets of instructions. One for those Jewish inner core chosen people of God, and one for those who are on the outside who are God-fearers. Now, here's where the mystery of God that Peter is starting to put together. Hidden at a time, but now revealed through Christ and through the coming of the Holy Spirit, is that God has already intended from the very beginning, even as he chose the chosen people, that it's not just going to be this exclusive club where only those can come before the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, but that all of humanity through the sacrifice of Jesus would be able to come and have communion and fellowship with our Lord. This is the mystery, that wall that divides those inner core with the outer God-fearers is going to be broken, that it's the same but different statues that God had. But here's where the corruption, if you look back up on the screen. In our brokenness and in our sinfulness, what we have created is this wall of not just division, but division of hostility. We have created hierarchy. We have created that we are the chosen, we are the favored, you are the unclean. And so we even look at the Holy Spirit's baptism and we say, well, we have it, you do not. We have the haves and the have-nots. Church, this is why this particular section in the book of Acts is so significant. What God is doing and what Peter is starting to understand is that through Christ, through the movement of the Holy Spirit, that not only is this wall coming down, but the hostility between the two people through Christ is now being removed. So read with me, okay? This is Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, it's up on the screens, starting verse 11. Therefore, remember at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Right? Now, Paul is going to talk to both groups, the Jew and to the Gentile. Verse 12, remember that you were at a time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Verse 14. For he himself, Christ himself, is our peace, who has made us both one, has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility through Christ. Continue, verse 17, and he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near.
Christ is reaching both near and far, Jew and Gentile. Verse 18, for through Christ we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundations of the apostles and prophets, Christ himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. You see, when we read in verse 34 in Acts chapter 10 that Peter is starting to understand that God shows no partiality, it's not a new revelation. God has intended this from the very beginning. There was a wall of hostility that was put up by our perversion in our sinfulness, in our desire to divide the haves and the have-nots. And even to the point where the Gentiles are looked upon as these untouchable, unclean. And yet, why is this such a monumental, life-changing, history-altering moment in the early church movement? Because God's Spirit comes and it proves to those who are the circumcised, do you see? Even those whom you have considered to be unclean will receive the same Spirit of God that you received in Acts chapter 2. So how then can we hold back the baptism of water and say that they are separate from who we are? That in Christ, he has killed the hostility, making two into one. Remember the core tenets that I was sharing with you? Through the work of the cross, we have been forgiven of our sins. And because of our purification through the blood of Christ, we have been reconciled to God, but we have also been reconciled to one another. You see, last week, Pastor Jamal Williams came and his message was, why go through Samaria? And he shared with us that there are people in our quote-unquote Samarias who are hungry, people who need to hear of this truth, that there are those who experience themselves as this unclean. We have to go. But remember that passage, as Pastor Jamal was sharing from John. John makes it very clear that Jesus had to go through Samaria. He had a divine appointment. He could have gone around as it was custom to do so, but Jesus had to go through his Samaria. Again, it's a fulfillment of what we see in Ephesians chapter, right? That he is going through Samaria to kill the hostility that we have put up in our sinfulness, in our brokenness. That in his son, in his sacrifice, that he is going to make two to become one. That in his physical going through Samaria is a demonstration of God's love at work, this new body in Christ. Brothers and sisters, do walls still exist in our communities today? You better believe it. Do we still have that tendency to go with haves and have-nots? You better believe it. Even within our own church, would I dare say that we have walls, things that keep us in our particular lanes, divide us? You know, church, let me level with you. I know it's been a challenging year, and it feels like it's been a challenging set of years. And I love that our worship team this morning, everything was about victory. But wouldn't you agree with me that so oftentimes it feels like we see more defeat than we see victory? It has been challenging. It is hard. It is difficult to be faithful, to feel like we're thriving and growing in our faith. I hear from our church, this year our whole theme is about being sent. How can we be sent when we struggle with our identity, our calling, our place, and our belonging? Even Jesus had to go through Samaria. Sometimes I wonder, we're sitting where we are and we're thinking, God, why am I not changing? We like to hold on to the fact that our sins have been forgiven, that we've been reconciled to the Father, but make no mistake, the reason why Acts 10 is such a pivotal moment in history is because through the cross, not only have we been reconciled to the Father, but we have been reconciled to one another. The work of the cross has killed the hostility that our sinfulness creates on a daily basis. We are to go and engage with our Samaritans because this is the evidence of the cross at work in our lives. So let me ask you, church, yes, we are to go into our everydays. But are there ways that we need to think and re-engage our everydays? Because let's be honest, our everydays have been built upon these divisions. I'll be the first to tell you, when we bought our house, we bought it because of the neighborhood, because of the school, because it separates us with those that are not like us. Yes, even those in my community need to see and hear the life, ministry, and the good news of Jesus, absolutely. But my faith would be amiss if that's all I'm looking at. Because make no mistake, again, as we see in Ephesians, throughout our passage, even through the book of Acts, God is going through the Samaritans. He is going to those who have and have not, to those that are near and to those that are far. What it means for us to grow, what it means for us to live into the gospel then is to embrace the breaking down of these dividing walls of hostility. You know, our brother Daniel shared this so well. We're called to go live out into our everydays, but brothers and sisters, let me be very clear. You know, one of the things that people say about our fellowship hall that pains me the most is that they say the fellowship hall, even though it's called the fellowship hall, is the most lonely and intimidating space in our entire church building. You know why? Because there is dividing walls of hostility in our fellowship hall that people feel invisible. They feel little, small, alone in our fellowship hall. And we sing about the victory of Christ, the walls that have been broken through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, and there are people who feel alone and unseen and invisible. These walls exist. It's so huge, so powerful, because what Peter is now starting to put together is that there is no difference, that Christ came to kill that difference, that we are to call to be living into that reality, to be an active part of tearing down these walls, to go through our Samaritans, to go and reach out to those near and far, because that is what Christ has done for you and for me. Not only where is our Samaria, but let me echo what our pastor Jamal shared with us. Why do you have to go through it? How is God calling us to live into this reality? Let's take a moment to pray, shall we? Brothers and sisters, I know it's not easy. Not easy for me to step out the bounds of my comforts. And the thing about habits and human nature is we're so used to living a certain way, we get set in them. But as God moves, as He speaks, as He challenges, I pray, beginning with myself, Father, that You not only convict, but Lord, that You would give me courage to engage, to go through my quote-unquote Samaritans, to share not only of how You have changed my life, but of the life, death, resurrection of our Lord Jesus that breaks down the walls of hostility. That in our church, Father, that we may live into the reality of the gospel that not only reconciles us to You, but to one another.
take a moment just to respond, shall we? And then our worship team will lead us. Let's pray.
If you're still in a place of response, please continue to do so. But if you're ready to join us in the last song, I would like for you to rise.
Father everlasting, the all-creating one.
Let's bow our heads together. Let's pray. Father, your Son, Jesus, came to our world knowing that there would be hostility, knowing that he would be rejected, that he would be crucified. But Father, your Son, Jesus, came and he lived among us. And it was said of him that he was a friend of sinners. Father, he came to love, to serve, to heal, to forgive, to preach the good news, to show the good news, and he died. And Father, he rose again from the grave, and he commanded us to now follow him as we live today in our everyday. Father, we remember the words of your Son, Jesus. As he has been sent, so he sends us. And so, Lord, everything that he did and everything we've read about, Lord, in today's passage, Lord, we pray that this would become more and more our lives in our everyday. So, Father, we want to pray specifically for the people and the places where we would just not see, where people are unseen, where people we would deem rejected or disqualified in any way. God, give us that second glance. Help us to look again. Father, help our hearts to grow in those places. We want to pray for some of us, our family members, for some of us, our workplaces, our schools, what's happening around us in the world and as we're watching on the news. Father, we pray for those places, as we heard last week, that are our Samarias, our Samaritans. And God, we pray that we would see how the gospel is able to reach and touch the hearts of any and every single person, God. So Lord, as a church, we come to this place this morning, and we want to ask for your Holy Spirit, as he did in Peter's heart, to do a work in our hearts as well. Lord, we offer to you our tithes, our offerings. God, this is just the beginning. Lord, there's so much more of us that we want to lay on the altar before you today for this upcoming week. God, we ask for your Holy Spirit to help us to grow in the likeness of Jesus, to be sent with power and authority. Lord, that's through Christ. And so we ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Good morning. Before we have a seat, can we turn to the people around us, and can you just give a friendly wave and a smile? If you're wearing a mask, just give a wave. And just say hi, just greet one another. Good morning, and welcome to our 9:20 service here at Open Door. For all of you who are here in person, on behalf of our church, I just want to say welcome. Thank you for joining us. And right after service, we want to invite you to our welcome room over there. And there'll be several of us who are there. We just want to greet you personally, answer any questions that you may have. For those of you who are joining us online, thank you for joining us. And if you have, if you're looking on the video platform, there's a live chat box there. There's someone from our greeting team ready to answer any questions that you may have. So please be sure to click on to that chat box. Yeah, the message, I'm still trying to process through the message. But in light of this message and just with the timing, as Pastor David mentioned, the gym and the fellowship hall, we would really love to make today that place and that space to be a space where we can just greet and welcome every single person here, every one of us. Several announcements. If you look up at the screen, we have our ODPC golf tournament, which is taking place. Registration is closed, but donations and sponsorship still continue. So we would love for you to partner with people who will be participating on that tournament. And it would be great if you can give. It goes towards missions cause. So it would be awesome for you to be involved in that way. We do have our infant toddler room open. Volunteers are needed. And so especially parents, if you're able to have your kids be in that room, it would be great for you to also sign up to serve as a volunteer. We have our upcoming classes for membership, adult baptism / adult confirmation, and also GC 101. Our Grove Winter Retreat is taking place in the latter part of December, but registration is open. So if any of us here have children who are in the Grove, or if any of us would like to volunteer or serve, please be sure to register. Our middle school is going ice skating in the beginning of November. Please be sure to go to the Planning Center. You'll find out more details and also instructions on how to register for ice skating. We have various serving opportunities going on here at our church. One of the great ways you can get connected with our church is by serving and serving alongside of others in all of our teams. So please be sure to check out the QR code and find all the different ways that you can get plugged in by serving. We do have a lot of other things going on here at our church, a lot of details, even with the slides that we just ran through. It's all on our church website, so please be sure to go to www.odpcec.org to find out more. And finally, we have prayer teams here up here in the front. Pastor David is here as well. If you'd like to receive prayer, please come up, and we'd love to pray for you. Throughout the week, we have the prayer wall, and if you just type in your prayer requests, we'll be praying for you also throughout the week. So with that, let's close in prayer. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for your word to us. And Father, we thank you for the words that you have spoken specifically to every one of us here, and in the time that we're hearing it right now, with all that's happening to each one of us. We ask, Father, that your Holy Spirit would lead each of us, as we've been seeing the Spirit do throughout the book of Acts, to people and into situations. We pray for the gospel, as we've been seeing in the book of Acts, the power of God for the salvation of all who would believe. Lord, we pray for the power of the gospel to be shared and spoken, but also demonstrated and seen and shown through all of us here. And so, Lord, this closing prayer, God, is a prayer of commissioning for every single one of us from this place. We pray that wherever we go, Lord, the walls of hostility would go down. We pray that the gospel would be shown and preached. We pray that the Holy Spirit would be ministering powerfully and effectively. We pray for the church, our church, and just the church with capital C church would just flourish and spread here in the DC area. So, Father, this is our prayer all together. And, Lord, that you'll send us off from this place. And so, brothers and sisters, to our guests, may the love of God our Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Please head over to the gym and the fellowship hall. We have food ready there. Please come up to receive prayer. And for all of our guests, we'll meet you in our welcome room. Inside, we can't hold back.
can see the promised land, though there's pain within the plan. There is victory in the end. Your love is my battle cry. When my fears like Jericho build the walls around my soul, when my heart is overthrown, your love is my battle cry, the answer for all my life. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken in two.